how does that play, you know, you can see now we've got a change in presidency. Let's just bring ourselves up to date just for a second. You know. How does all this play out in our times? Because you can see that the guy that's coming in, this gentleman that's coming in, has some very interesting plans. And it's actually the first time in a long time that a businessman has become the president anyway.
Yeah, well...
that's quite a significant move.
Yeah, my best sense of it is with, you know, with the cabinet he's already nominated, for the people he's nominated for his cabinet, seems to be that he is playing out the, you know, just forming the most fascist government we've seen. Now, you know, people, you know, good researchers like the late David McGowan has documented how fascism is already really a part of the United States and how it's been increasing, ever increasing from, say, Reagan to Bush to Bill Clinton to Bush Jr. It's just been increasing in our country, and he showed how that played out. Though it's really you can say that under Trump it's just reached its highest levels. You know, it seems like it'll reach its highest level, and it's very, you know, it's very scary. It's very dangerous. Now with Obama, prosecuted many whistleblowers, and it's really dangerous how many whistleblowers he prosecuted and put in jail. Though I'm glad he, you know, at least said he was commuting some sentences, such as that Chelsea Manning sentence.
Yeah.
But he also conducted bombing campaigns throughout the world, rose the bombing campaigns to unseen levels. You know, and so it was this creepy, this continuing increase of fascism, and the ever increasing Pentagon budget was sadly enough increased. You know, it was continued under Obama, and now it just seems like it's going to even, you know, skyrocket under Trump. And Trump is just so blatantly racist and blatantly sexist and blatantly fascist. His daily mentor, was a red baiting, communist hunting boy named Roy Cohn, who was the right hand man of Senator Joe McCarthy, who got loads of people suspected of being members of the Communist Party kicked out of their jobs, helped lead the movement that got the Rosenbergs executed, the only officially, you know, executed civilians during peacetime, and the attacks on so many people for being leftists of any sort. And so it was a huge purge in our country of people, you know, who were they were concerned that were leftists. And it just seems like Trump is going to just lead that move to purge the country of all leftist activists.
So that you think that you see a very dangerous. You see a very dangerous time coming with this man.
It could be. It just seems like it really could be a dangerous time coming. I hope I'm wrong. But yeah, it does seem very scary and dangerous.
And all of this really links up with the whole drug trafficking industry, because that's how they basically muted a lot of minds, which was by flooding the market with all these cheap, you know, these cheap drugs. I mean, whether they got crystal meth now, you know, I mean, that thing makes you look 10 years older in a few months.
Yeah, well, they've got all kinds of different drugs out there. Yeah, crystal meth is popular in some regions of the United States and destroys lives in some regions. LSD is popular everywhere, sadly enough, because that was an MKUltra drug that, you know, all the research I found, and I show the research studies in my book, how they're saying that appears to cause some mild cerebral damage and hurt the minds of many young youth that could be potentially good activists and help change society for the better. And so the same thing, they found even more blatant cerebral damage with ecstasy, which ecstasy is a part of, you know, and that drug's become hugely popular and even more popular these days in the black. It used to be more popular in the white community, but now it's gotten really popular in the black community.
Yeah.
Some of the people I counsel, I can just see the damage that the ecstasy has done. It's very sad. I got, you know, people I counsel to see, friends of theirs, ecstasy. So these are really dangerous drugs. And what they do is they use, you know, the positions to all the media they own to promote these drugs. And so, you know, when I talk about these top positions, you know, it started with, of course, like John Lennon and Jimi Hendrix in the 60s, where an undercover agent, a guy I consider undercover agent, a dentist, was the person that gave John Lennon his first hit of acid and dumped it into his coffee. His wife, Cynthia, and Harrison, over George Harrison's dentist house. And so they drink the coffee, and they're dosed with acid, and then they're told afterwards. And John Lennon was furious to be dosed with LSD, never tried before. Yeah. George Harrison said, you know, what's LSD? Never even heard of it before in this time of 1965. So, and then I showed the evidence that, the fact that a guy named Robert Lashbrook, who was assistant director of the MKUltra program under the CIA, had come to London with tons of LSD. And this is according to a writer named A.E. Hotchner, who was Ernest Hemingway's longtime editor.
Yeah.
Hotchner said that Lashbrook took tons of LSD and money to London and tried to get it in as many musicians' hands as possible.
Yeah.
And the, you know, reasons why are pretty obvious: to get them to promote drugs to the activist youth. And that's what they did, of course. Now, Mick Jagger is another example of someone who... Mick Jagger actually resisted using acid until 1967, when an undercover agent, FBI agent, Schneiderman, was in London at the time at a party. He befriended Keith Richards, and they were at a party of his, and they finally convinced Mick Jagger to use LSD for the first time. And so not only the place they were using LSD, a party, was busted. Mm-hmm. So the police had made big news that you know, that Mick Jagger was caught tripping using LSD. And then, so now he's under legal authority's thumb.